Get on board, we're ready to go. See the world from the scenic railroad. From the snow-capped mountains to the sunny coast. On the great scenic railway journey.
Welcome to Great Scenic Railway Journeys. I'm your host, David Holt. We're on the Durango and Silverton narrow gauge line, hailed as one of the top scenic railroad destinations in the world. So join me now in this wondrous place where every day is 1882 and there's always a steam train to catch. Coming up next on Great Scenic Railway Journeys.
You know, these locomotives, when they're sitting here and they don't have a fire in them, they're dead. They seem lifeless. But you put a fire in one and you get it under steam and it comes alive. The whole engine seems to be living.
In Durango, Colorado, a fierce resurrection takes place. Antique locomotives rumbling through the San Juan Mountains. 290,000-pound dragons hugging 400-foot cliffs, delicately balanced on a thin ribbon of steel just 36 inches wide. This is narrow-gauge railroading at its finest. Through the narrow cut you travel, canyons shape-shift into emerald waterways. Granite cliffs yield to lush meadows. The air thins, clouds skirt the skyline. You've passed the 9,000-foot mark and the grade elevates.
Just spectacular country. You can't find it anywhere else in the world.
It's just so awesome, the height of everything. And the trees, I can't believe how the trees way up high can be alive on the rock.
For 45 miles, you journey north from Durango to Silverton, once a three-day stagecoach ordeal. Now, a 3-hour and 40-minute wonder ride. And when you get to Silverton, one always does wonder.
All you have to do is go outside and take a look at these, how remote this country is, and you have to say, why in the world would anybody ever come here and do what they did and build what they did?
What kind of man would have the audacity to try and build a railroad in this wilderness? A 19th century railroad that could boast that its routes went through the Rockies, not around them. Such courage and daring, a bold battlefield plan. A man well acquainted with challenge. Meet General William J. Palmer.
Palmer was a very interesting man and super intelligent, super resourceful.
And super bored after the Civil War.
General Palmer was still trying to figure out what he was going to do with his life, and so were a lot of other people. They were kind of, the South and the North were still trying to rebuild, and a lot of people just wanted a new life.
A life out west.
What he wanted to do originally was build a railroad from Denver to Durango, Mexico.
But the good general decided Durango, Colorado might be a better fit. Mexico might have milder winters, but in the 1800s, Colorado winters were scorching with treasure deep in the San Juan Mountains.
These mining communities were springing up in the Rocky Mountains. They needed rail service really bad. That was the key to making the mining work, was a railroad. And he started to build narrow gauge railroads into the mountains to these mining towns. And Silverton was probably the most remote of them all.
Silverton, a tiny town surrounded by giant peaks, mountains that used to be part of a giant volcano. When the volcano rumbled, minerals rose up, making this 12,000 square mile region one of the geologically richest in North America, but completely isolated until Palmer's train rolled up from Durango, a train you'll ride. Once you get off the train in Silverton, you'll be taking a step back in time, strolling through town, enjoying Victorian storefronts surrounded by high mountain splendor. By the way, I'm standing on the only paved street in town. These days, Silverton streets, paved and otherwise, are lined with tourists. But in 1883, the place was packed with dreams of silver in a red light district. A busy jail full of prostitutes, prospectors, gamblers, and general lawlessness, all preserved in a most orderly fashion these days. Beth, this is a wonderful museum. Tell us just a little about it.
Well, this is the Mining Heritage Center, focused on the mining history of the San Juan Mountains.
What years?
1874 until about 1990.
At the Mining Heritage Center, you can immerse yourself in the history of Silverton, from the detailed mineral collection to the actual mining equipment used to extract such precious metals. Spend a little time in here, and you can figure out pretty quickly how the town of Silverton got its name.
We mined silver by the ton.
Miners sometimes work miles under the earth in search of fortune. But the initial silver fever was followed by a panic.
In 1893, the United States demonetized silver, and it caused it to bust, and that was the silver panic.
That started the downgrading of the whole area, kind of fell into a recession. A lot of the mines closed, they couldn't stay open, except for the bigger ones. And that was followed by a world war, by the Depression, by a Second World War. By the 1940s, Silverton was kind of shut down as far as the mining was concerned.
As Silverton's fortunes declined, so did Durango's. The smelter shut down. Durango was down, but not out. After surviving silver panics, two world wars, the smelter closing, and the Great Depression, the Durango train was in dire financial straits. That's when Hollywood discovered a real live train operation, and these vintage locomotives became stars of the silver screen, including this movie, one of my favorites, Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid.
I would have to say Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid was probably the biggest movie shot here. Of course, Rio Grande was great. Running two locomotives, actually not using models, but two real steam engines, and running them into each other head on is certainly an interesting thing to do. But they did that back then. That was the way they did things.
The railroad put up with Hollywood's demands because of the immense payoff. Right from the start, with the 1950 release Ticket to Tomahawk, there was a new kind of silver to mine, the silver screen, and a new way to get to Durango's train by automobile.
And folks were watching Western movies that were being filmed out here. They thought, wow, that is such a great place. It's beautiful. I'd like to go visit that. Let's hop in the car and drive there. And that was the new fortune to be made. Instead of hauling tons of material out of the mountains, precious metals and so forth, now we're hauling people. People are our gold and silver now. And because of Hollywood, which was a huge benefit to us to discover this area, they really launched the tourism in this area.
The beauty of the area proved to be a temperamental stage, and the constant onslaught of snow, slides, and floods, along with the encroachment of diesel trains, threatened to put the steam locomotives on the skids. And the owners of the railroad, the Denver and Rio Grande Western Company, wanted out.
they were really trying to get out of this whole thing, the steam, the old cars. Keeping the track in good shape between here and Silverton was a big job for them. And in 1970, the Rio Grande had some help. There was a big flood that wiped out 11 miles of track. And at that time, the Rio Grande thought, hey, we're done here.
After we had the flood of 1970, the railroad put it up on the real estate block.
It would take 11 years to sell the legendary train operation. During that time, severe neglect set in.
There were times that we thought it would never make up the hill, and we kind of just crossed our fingers. This was before Mr. Bradshaw, of course.
In 1981, Charles Bradshaw Jr., a Florida citrus grower, bought the Colorado Railroad with a goal in mind.
He comes in here with a dream. He is going to rebuild the entire railroad. He will replace all the 65-pound rail with 90-pound rail. He's going to straighten out curves. He's going to take locomotives that have been parked over in Alamosa for 30 years. He's going to bring these engines over here and restore them and put them into service.
He wanted to keep the running it the way an old railroad should be run. Authenticity was one of his main words, and he believed that. So what you see around here was simply because of his authenticity program. We considered him the savior of the narrow gauge.
Bradshaw's resolve was put to the test February 10th, 1989. Sometime after midnight, a fire broke out at the Durango Roundhouse.
Flames were coming out the ceiling of the roof of the roundhouse and smoke and all that. So as we walked around the perimeter of this building, the roundhouse, Mr. Bradshaw says, well, he says, we'll just have to rebuild it. The day after that, we all looked to see what was really how bad it was, and it was bad. I mean, all the locomotives, stuff fell on top of the locomotives and stuff. Because everything was scattered all over the roundhouse at the time of the fire, we called this the open air roundhouse.
We had a couple short walls left, no roof, and we had the cement area and the pits, and that's all we had. And the fire was in February, and we had scheduled trains out in May. Yeah, it was remarkable that the crew could pull together, get the locomotives back together, get them operational, get them out of town, and get them back.
The way this place pulled together to bring these locomotives out of the ashes was truly amazing. And we ended up having one of the biggest years we've ever had here.
Rising out of the ashes, the Durango and Silverton Narrow Gauge Railroad became a state-of-the-art operation. Al Harper took over in 1998. And under his leadership, the narrow gauge line blossomed. The tracks he walks today are ridden by hundreds of thousands of passengers each year, satisfied customers embracing Harper's philosophy.
We can never give up this heritage. We can never let it slide. We've got to make sure that we revere and remember these great historic projects. The best way to save history is to make its presentation so interesting and exciting that people will pay a fair price for the experience.
Harper's vision has led this line in a new direction, one that includes combining history along with entertainment.
I have really focused in the last 12, 13 years of how to get more families and children on board.
Is this you?
Well, yeah.
Well,
special events like the Polar Express, Public Television's Dinosaur Train, and Charlie Brown's Great Pumpkin Patch are just some of the venues that the railroad offers that's now drawing a new generation of rail fans.
We have found that on a weekend, we can get 5,000, 6,000, 7,000 children out if we do a good job, and we introduce them to railroading.
For many, though, the star attraction is the railroad's iron horses.
It's here in the Durango rail yard, I feel like a kid in the middle of a big, giant train set. Now, behind me is the roundhouse, where mechanics work on these historic steam locomotives.
We can do 98% of what needs to be done to these steam locomotives in our shop here.
Randy Babcock knows the work he does is unusual for someone his young age.
Fewer and fewer people take up this sort of trade, and even machinists nowadays, everything's so automated, there's not as much manual machines remaining out there to work on.
On this day, Babcock is putting steam train tires onto wheels, a tad more complicated than an auto garage.
Here you're actually having to cut the metal and fit it to the wheel. And this one is different from the next one I'll do, from the next one after that by a little bit. No two are alike. That's the biggest difference, and this will not come back off. Whereas a tire, you can change again. This has to be cut off.
It's precise and tough work.
To be a system mechanic on a steam railroad, you have to have a willingness to get dirty and have it not bother you. Everything is heavy, everything is hot, everything is dirty.
The grueling work has a payoff beyond a paycheck.
I hope, you know, that my kids can come over here in another couple of decades and enjoy this or be a part of this as I've been able to.
And we're maintaining a part of history, and because of that, there's virtually millions of people that have come here and enjoyed our equipment, our ride, and our railroad.
There's at least 3,000 moving parts that make up a steam engine. It's an amazing symphony of science.
Steam locomotive is probably the ultimate piece of mechanical engineering. Then everything on the locomotive either rotates or reciprocates or in some fashion moves. And of course it's all friction bearing. There's no roller bearing in this, so they are really kind of designed to almost wear themselves out and tear themselves apart as they operate.
And because of the wear and tear, the trains are inspected closely. In the morning, there's one sound you're bound to hear.
So tapping is an important part to make sure there's no breaks or cracks, right?
That's correct. We need to make sure that when this train goes out in the morning, it's got all of its parts working properly.
Sounds like rhythm to me. Let's play it. Playing the train.
There's lots of sounds associated with a steam train. The rumble of the tracks, the steam blast, and of course,
whistle. You can't overlook the emotion and the of a locomotive whistle like the ones we have here. And I mean, it's just absolutely wonderful.
I think one of the things that affects me the most deeply is to hear that whistle in the canyon. And then to hear the echo of that whistle coming back. is really, really cool.
And really, really authentic.
But it's a lot of fun to know that there is a railroad in this country that exists, that you can still hear the whistles of an old steam locomotive. Look at these locomotives built in 1923. I mean, who would have thought that they would be running this well this long?
The Durango and Silverton Narrow Gauge Railroad also boasts authentic rolling stock.
One of the things about this rolling stock that we have here is it's always been here. A lot of the cars are as old as the railroad itself, and they are meticulously maintained. This stuff has been running as hard as it was when it was brand new, and it's in its 80s or it's even over 100 years old. We've got the San Juan class, which was the old first class passenger cars. We have our restoration cars, which are authentic 19th century Jackson and Sharp, Bill Meyer and Small coaches that we've restored. We've got a couple of new glass roofed observation cars that are pretty cool.
In fact, this area right here is, for example, the highest cliff above the train. So if you were riding in a regular coach, you wouldn't be able to see the 600 feet of cliff that are directly above us right now.
Chief Conductor Rich Millard is happy to showcase the latest first-class car.
Tell us about this car we're in. This is an incredible Night Sky.
Night Sky. This is our newest car, and it's actually a sister to a car called the Silver Vista that was actually operated back in the 1940s and 50s, the original one. And it was unique to the narrow gauge railroads because of this beautiful glass roof above us. You get to see all the soaring cliffs, which is a very unique perspective.
Some people call this a time machine. Do you really feel like that sometimes?
You know, I couldn't think of a better time machine than this railroad. You know, to start with, you're riding in coaches that could have been built as early as 1878. We're being pulled by authentic coal-fired steam locomotives, hand-shoveled. They were just like they were when they rolled off the factory floor. In addition to being in this spectacular, inaccessible wilderness area where you can't physically see modern conveniences of electricity, houses, etc., if you really sit back and just let yourself soak this all in, it could absolutely be 1882 all over again.
Totally awesome. It's just something that you can't describe. You look up and you feel very small in looking at everything, and it's phenomenal. There's just nothing more that you can say about it.
I like the river because it's pretty to watch, and the waterfall falls down into it.
I like the rocking motion of the train. It's very lulling, peaceful, romantic. I like it.
One part of this journey is not only liked, but loved. It's been drawing visitors from around the world since the opening of the line in 1882.
The High Line is the highlight of the trip. The train snakes along a narrow rock shelf that's blasted out of the granite cliffs. If you're afraid of heights, don't look down. The Animas River is 400 feet below.
Several publications have rated this ride on the Durango and Silverton as one of the top 10 rides in the world. And the High Line, where we're standing on these cliffs, is probably the most single photograph site on any railroad in the world.
And one of the most expensive. To build the High Line, workers had to blast and level 2 miles of cliffs at a cost of $1,000 a foot.
You would think building such an impressive track would have been well documented, but there are no photos of the High Line construction, and for good reason.
They didn't allow any photography to be taken because the conditions were rather horrific. We don't know if there were any fatalities, but certainly people were hit with debris, they were burned. You know, the explosions would injure them. In fact, there are written accounts from the wives that were in the camp there, they called it Camp One in Rockwood, of rocks actually landing in the camp, which is quite a distance from where they were actually blasting, so there must have been some pretty big explosions.
There may be no photos of the High Line construction, but the history of the Durango and Silverton Narrow Gauge Railroad is well documented at the museum housed in the original roundhouse. The museum opened in 1998 and houses a fine collection of railroad memorabilia. There are lamps, locks, china, art, photos, books, maps, full-size coaches and locomotives. Now, number 42 is the oldest locomotive here, and it dates back to 1887. Now, the great thing about this place, it's all free. It's all part of your train ticket.
When you're walking up to the museum, you see an old brick building, and there's just a small sign on the door that says museum. And they open that door, and the first thing they see is a pretty big room full of locomotives, and there's the fire truck right there, and they go, wow! And especially kids, I see adults do it too.
Whether on the tracks or in the yard, young and old alike share the amazement. Generations bridged by the common love of trains.
Well, I think history is extremely important, and I think it's wonderful that they actually can operate this train as a for-profit business to keep it going, and I hope they do it forever and ever and ever for the kids so they can see the way things work.
As long as we have folks that want to ride this train and experience what went on here in the 19th century, we'll take them through the canyon. We'll do it.
This is a permanent thing. We're not playing trains. We're running them.
We are a railroad. We're in an 1882 experience. Steam is reality. Coal-fired steam is reality. You know, this is an American treasure. For us to be the guardians of history, we need to make this experience exact. If you want to go home knowing that you experienced the same ride that somebody did 125 years ago, ride the Durango and Silverton.
Well, I hope you enjoyed our visit to the Durango and Silverton Narrow Gauge Railroad. The 482 is on another run. Now, don't call it a locomotive. Nope, it's a coal-fired, steam-powered time machine. Something I hope you can experience, too. Until then, I'm David Holt. See you on the next great scenic railway journeys.
Get on board, we're ready to go. See the world from the scenic railroad. From the snow-capped mountains to the sunny coast. On the great scenic railway.